Several announcements that I need to go ahead and do. First, birthdays. Yeah, I saw that on Facebook. Somebody's got to say their name. I've got a policy. I don't call nobody's name unless a family member calls their name. Jim. Oh, wow. I did not know that, Jim. Jim's having a birthday tomorrow, and pretty sure he's like 90, 92. I wasn't sure if it's 91 or 92. But Jim's having a birthday, and who else is? Brittany's having a birthday. Oh, I broke my policy. I mean, I said Brittany. See what I do? Today. Well, Brittany out there. Raise your hand, wave. I say, hey, am I having a birthday? Okay. Who else? Somebody else having a birthday? Do you have your hand up, or are you just acting like your daddy? Anybody else? How about any anniversaries? Any anniversaries? We got y'all's last week, didn't we? I think. Because y'all having one, ain't you? Mr. Barker, ain't y'all having one? Yeah. Oh, I thought I saw it was coming up. I didn't want to miss it. Too early, I'm sorry. All right, well, let's sing happy birthday to all these guys.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
All right, don't like to pass things around, but I am going to pass this around. Let's see, I got to write somebody's name down here. Time out. This is a sign-up sheet for Horn to West. So the Senior Adult Ministry is planning a trip next Friday night to go see Horn in the West. If you are 55 and over, the cost is $7. If you're above or below 55, you're still welcome to go, but you'll have to pay the full $17. So that's next Friday. We'll be leaving the church here at 4 o'clock and going out to eat. And then I'm pretty sure everybody behind me gets the $7 deal, in case anybody was wondering. Somebody's like, do I have to pay? Yeah. Let me pass this around. I'll start back here. If nobody wants to go, that is fine. But I know there's several wanting to go, and I'm excited about it because I ain't seen it in over 20 years. So that's next Friday night. If you want to go, you're welcome to go with us. I will order the tickets in the morning. So whoever's name's on this list, when I get it back today, that's who I'm ordering tickets for. All right. There's something else. Faith Fest is August the 31st. That's the Christian Music Festival down at Wilkes College in Wilkesboro, and our youth is going. The cost is $10 a person. If you have any questions, see Lori. Do you have anything else to say? Today's the last day. Thank you, Lori. Today is the last day to order, says Wendy, the official assistant of Lori. So... Okay, Faith Fest. Okay, what other going-ons are they? Some of the youth and kids are leaving today to go to camp, and so let's be praying for them. We'll bring them up again later, but what else is going on? Anybody else got anything? August 24th, Doe River Gorge. I'm going to that. I'm going to go ride the train again. So you're welcome to go. All right, if nothing else then, we'll, huh? Oh, church picnic. Thank you, Larry. I told you I got two or three more things to do just from the fellowship all over here. And I run out of fingers, and I try to write things down, and then my pen don't work. So somebody write Janie's name on that list, please. I just thought about that. Whoever got to write down Janie's list, yeah. Okay. The church picnic, that is the 18th, right? The 18th. Yeah, that's two Sundays from now. That's a church picnic, and so we'll be up at the Lansing Park, and everyone's invited. We always have a good time and good eating and good fellowship. All right.
Wait.
Yes.
The fire department at Lansing is having an open house on the 24th, and there's going to be a whole lot of things for the kids to do. We'll be doing blood pressure checks, blood sugar checks. Marshall from Pawhets will be there.
Okay. 24th, Lansing Fire Department having the open house. I know that's a big deal for them. If you look in your bulletin also, you'll see this. This is a long ways away, but not that far. But this is not till September 28th. But we want to go ahead and get the word out. I want Warrensville Baptist Church to support this fundraiser for the Pregnancy Center like never before. They need our support. I'm so excited. The director, the new director that they have, is getting back to the roots of what a pregnancy center ought to be, and I'm very excited about it. And so we want to do that. If you want to walk in, if you want to plan on it, but either way, we want to help them raise money because we believe in our local pregnancy center. All right, Brother Isaac, you come lead us. Let's begin our worship. That ain't nothing.
Let's all stand and sing hymn number 393, The Family of God.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Join us with Jesus as we travel this sod, for I'm part of the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Join us with Jesus as we travel this sod, for I'm part of the family of God.
Number 328, we'll sing Sweet, Sweet Spirit.
You say Jesus all the way.
Seated.
I'm glad about half of you smiled when we were singing about the expression on our face. All right, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer as we lift up some prayer concerns, and we do have a lot. And first of all, I want to mention about Dexter. I put out a little quick message yesterday. Just to let everybody know that there has been some improvement. And when you've had none and you get some, that might seem like a whole lot. And so he actually walked, I believe Lois said, about 40 feet. Now, the other day, Lois was coming down two sets of steps. Just two sets of steps. And her foot slipped off the top one and landed on the second one and chipped her heel bone there. And so she's in a soft cast. She can't put any weight on it, so she can't walk. So just to kind of add to the beauty of this whole situation. And as always, like you might imagine, you know, Lois is in pretty good spirits. But appreciate all the encouragement. I want to say even Rick Davis, our fire chief from down the mountain that's here once every couple weeks, him and his wife, he was able to go visit and wasn't that far away. So that was, for some reason, he likes Dexter. I can't figure. But I thought that was really, really cool. And so just so you know, we're going to do a love offering toward the end of the service to help the Barkers because they got a lot going on. So Debbie and Nick is trying to work with Lois now to get her down there and bring her back because she can't stay the night. So all that's going on with them. So let's continue to pray for them. Let's keep praying for Terry. Would David like to give us an update?
We took a ride in the car yesterday.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Good. That's awesome. So we'll keep praying for Terry. Anybody else?
Our cousin, Kelly Day, she's in the bad wreck, flushed out of Missouri, and she's in Winston right now, so I would like to invite her.
Okay.
We need to remember the victims of both of these mass shootings.
Yeah, you kind of run out of things to say about that, don't you? I've talked to, the Owens family. Okay. I can't believe there's several people I hadn't heard, but there was another mass shooting at 1 o'clock this morning in Ohio, and there I believe it's 9 people dead and 20 wounded. And yesterday it was 20 dead and 26 wounded at a Walmart in Texas and. So let's do pray for those families. Anybody else?
My brother Tom.
Your brother Tom, okay. Anybody else got a special prayer request? Larry Call. Your brother, okay. Okay, your mom and Virgil. Okay, Miss Judy, we'll do.
Yes, ma'am.
All right, let's be with, think about praying for the kids this week. I'm telling you, two of them has already made a decision, and this week is going to do nothing but just back that up, and I'm excited about that. All right, let's go, Lord. Huh? It is good to see Donnie back. Where's he at? Oh, there he is. I look for y'all back there. But it is good to see him back. Thank you. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just bow right now before your throne of grace, thanking you for all your many blessings. And God, we come before you today to begin with just a heavy heart about things. But Lord, none of these events caught you by surprise. You are, and we are well aware that there is evil in this world. And Lord, we pray for these families. Any life lost is terrible. But God, we think about people just shopping. And God, I pray for these families that have lost a loved one that way. I can't imagine. Lord, I pray for every request that's been mentioned today. You know each and every one. Now we pray that your will would be accomplished. God, we ask that you'd use us in a mighty way that we might be able to help and to encourage these folks. We have unspoken. Every one of us has something on our heart, and we just want to lift that up to you today. I want to say that we love you today, God. You're worthy to be praised. God, you deserve all of our worship and our praise. And God, I pray today as we continue our service that we'll just keep on doing that. Just keep on praising you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Let's all stand again and sing hymn number 245.
I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty. Sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Everything now I gladly own him as my king. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. At Calvary, mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary.
Andrew, would you lead us in this prayer?
Thank you.
song we're singing this morning, we sang a few weeks ago, and we sang it Monday night at the Methodist Church. And if you feel inspired to sing along with us today, feel free to do so.
I'm so glad.
All right, Children's Church. Who we got doing that? Pam and Amanda? All right. That's a beautiful, beautiful thing right there. It's always funny how everybody gets quiet right at the same moment. Getting a look. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I'll change my look. I love seeing it. Nothing like good Christian fellowship, is there? Being around people like Faith and your brothers and sisters, that's good. Well, if you'll take your Bibles today and turn to Acts chapter 11, I've enjoyed the worship. It's always amazing how some of the songs always line up. And, of course, if you don't know what the sermon's about, then I'm the only one sharing this experience like, oh, that's spot on right there. But hopefully by the end of it, you'll know what I'm talking about. Acts chapter 11. Of course, we are going through the book of Acts on Wednesday night. And several weeks ago, the Lord laid on my heart just to continue on Sunday morning as well, because there's so much good stuff in here. And I believe the Lord has a message for us. So today, we're talking about being a Barnabas. Now, you'll forgive me, at some point in time during this sermon, I may refer to Barnabas as Barabbas. That could very possibly happen. So if I say Barabbas at any time during this sermon, you just insert Barnabas, okay? I interchange those too easy. There's a story that's found in here that's so remarkable. It's about partnership. It's about companionship. And later on, it's about conflict resolution. But it's a story about a man named Barnabas. Now, we mentioned this briefly last week, but I felt like this warranted its own sermon. So our focus today is about a man who served in the shadows. Most of his ministry, he served in the shadows. In fact, I think most of us would just as soon serve in the shadows. You know what I'm talking about? Most of us feel more comfortable sitting down there than standing up here. And I know that sometimes it may appear that I like the limelight. But I can tell you, I really don't. But I've yet to figure out how to be a preacher and not stand up here. If I could sit back here in the room back there and just y'all hear my voice, I'd do that. Y'all probably like that too. I've only met a few people in my life that they desire to be out front all the time. And to be honest with you, it was a little bit hard to be around them if you was around them too much. And you probably know a few people like that. They want to be the center of attention all the time. It's kind of like Kevin Tedder, if you know what I'm talking about. Now, if you know Kevin, he's the exact opposite of that. But I think we all can relate. When I make this statement, I think we all can relate about when I say being a Barnabas. Barnabas is introduced the first time back in Acts chapter 4 and in verse 36. The Bible says, and where we would probably want to say Joseph, but that's pronounced with an E in the Greek. Iosis, something like that. But that word means exalted. But the Bible tells us that in verse 36, who by the apostles was surnamed Barnabas. Don't you love when somebody just changes your name? You know, you got a name, and somebody just starts calling you something else. That ever happened to anybody? One of my deacons, I won't mention his name, Jim, but God, I let that slip out. He calls me something, and it ain't Wade. Okay, it's not bad, but it's not Wade. Bible says in chapter 4, verse 36, which is being interpreted, the son of consolation. Another word we could use there is encouragement. He was a Levite in the country of Cyprus. The disciples changed his name from being exalted to being one of encourager. I like that name better, don't you? The next mention we find of Barnabas, he's associated with Paul, and we just covered that last week in chapter 9, verse 27. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and that he had spoken to him, and how he preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. So the scriptures provide enough detail to discern the life of Barnabas. Barnabas was a faithful servant of the Lord. And most of his time, he served in the shadows because he was foreshadowed by Paul. We always hear Paul, and we may hear Paul and Barnabas. I'll show you a little bit where Scripture even says Barnabas and Paul. I thought that was neat. I'd never seen that before because I always say Paul and Barnabas, Paul and Barnabas. But in even Scripture, it said Barnabas and Paul. Our churches today are filled with those who quietly go about their work. There's so many people, excuse me, in our church that does things that never gets credit for it. They never get the limelight for it or anything because they don't want it. So they quietly go about serving their Lord, amen, by serving His church. Faithfully serving the Lord. Making significant contributions. And yet, sometimes their service goes largely unnoticed. And while many people who do things, while they're, it may go unnoticed, it's not unappreciated, amen? And it's certainly not unnecessary. I want to examine today the characteristics of this faithful servant that we're looking at today and consider being a Barnabas. So I want to do that by, first of all, looking at his calling. We've talked about the calling of Paul. We've talked about the calling of several people. And every time I think about the calling, I remember the day when God called me to preach. I know the exact day. I know the exact hour. I know the exact minute that God called me to preach. And the day He called me to preach, I accepted. I didn't run. I didn't know what else to do. It scared me to death. Like, whatever, Lord. I'll do whatever. So, when you were called to do something, and we're all called to do something. Can I get an amen, church? We're all called to do something. It may be serving in the shadows. It may be just an encourager. It may be an assistant or whatever the case might be. But how many knows how important an assistant is? Amen. So we're going to talk about his calling here for just a minute. Because in verses 19 through 23... and we'll read a couple verses as we go along here in just a second. But it is here in chapter 11, verses 19 through 23, that we get a glimpse of the great move of God that was going on during this time. The church was being born, right? So we go down to verse 21, and I want us to see first that there was an anticipation to Barnabas' calling. So look at verse 21. And the hand of the Lord was with them. And a great number believed and turned unto the Lord. Then tidings, verse 22, of these things came into the ears of the church which was at Jerusalem. See, what I want us to see here is a beautiful story. And in this story, I think we can learn a lot of things. But it is in this story that we realize that they had went down to Antioch. And we'll see that in just a minute. But word came back to Jerusalem, hey, there's some good things going on down there. Can I say that when we hear about good things going on at a church, we ought to be happy about it. Sadly, I have heard other preachers and other people in this community put down a church that's growing like wildfire. And that breaks my heart. And one particular person that really bothered me that said something, I let them know about it. I don't think they liked it, but I didn't care. Because they needed to know, when there's a work of God going on, you better be happy about it. And I know what his problem was. His problem was that same work wasn't going on at his church. And that's sad. That's sad. Now, I ain't saying I ain't jealous. I'm like, whoo, can you send a little of that fire my way? But it's just exploding. When we hear things going on, you see, in this story right here, remember, this is not that far away from the persecution that led to the stoning of Stephen. We remember that. Stephen says, I'll do the ministry for you, Lord. And he got stoned to death. Thanks, God. But we're still talking about him today, aren't we? What an encouragement Stephen's ministry was to us. And so the church was scattered and they made their way to Antioch. It was about 300 miles, 300 to 400 miles north of Jerusalem. So the church had begun to get scattered way, way, way away from Jerusalem. And they heard about it in Jerusalem that something was happening up in Antioch. And you know what the believers did in Jerusalem? They got excited. They got excited about it. This is the setting in which Barnabas was commissioned for service. There was anticipation. Anybody remember that ketchup commercial? Anticipation. I think about it. You never seen a commercial with anticipation about ketchup? You'll have to look that up. I believe that such anticipation will change the way you look at ministry, will change the way you look, will change your attitude, will change your efforts. How many knows this morning that when you anticipate something, you get excited about it? Some of you are going to think back about a few years, but when you remember when you was a kid and you'd anticipate Christmas? Hey, was anybody up this morning at 6:30? Boy, today is Sunday. I get to go to church. Woo-hoo! Was you? Well, if you were, bless you, brother. A little child was. The Bible says we ought to have faith like a child, right? I like that. There was an anticipation about what God was doing. And you know what? That work that's going on here and other churches in our area, guess what? It's happening here too. It's happening here. You say, where's it happening at? Just look around. You'll see it. You'll see it walk across the parking lot. You'll see it here. I'm anticipating great things for Warrensville Baptist Church. And it's exciting. It's an exciting time to be part of Warrensville Baptist Church. There was an anticipation of what God was doing. So to move on about his calling just for a minute, look on in verse 22, the second part of verse 22. It says, "And they sent forth Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch." And so we see that they approved of his calling. Here's the church in Jerusalem. Something's going on up there at Antioch. God's moving. God's working up in Antioch. So we're going to send forth Barnabas to go help them in Antioch, to go see what's going on up there at Antioch. This, my friends, is a biblical basis of missions. The idea of a church saying, you know what? We're going to send somebody out. See, it was the church of Jerusalem that sent Barnabas up there. Missionaries are called of the Lord, commissioned of the church, and sent out to serve the Lord. Their work and their ministry is embraced by the local church. I got to thinking about this. The local church approves, encourages those that have volunteered for mission work. We've seen several of our people go out from this church, go on mission trips, and we have supported them. Thank you. This church has supported mission work very well. In fact, this is a mission-minded church. I don't know, but you can get a copy of the budget back there and see where our money goes. There's no secret here about the money at our church, is there? And so you can look exactly where every penny goes. And so you can look on our budget and see that we give a lot of money to missions, community missions. We support our local association, the Pregnancy Center, Ash Really Cares. We support the Cooperative Program, which is the mission program of the Southern Baptist Convention. And some might say, well, I don't like to support somebody I'll never see. Well, guess what? The Southern Baptist, between the North American Mission Board and the International Mission Board, we support almost 10,000 missionaries fully. In other words, those missionaries are not spending 6 months out of the year at our churches raising money so they could be over there for 6 months. Our missionaries are over there for 12 months of the year, and then they get a break. And so that's our mission program. Our church is a mission-minded church. Amen? I appreciate that. I really do. I think about those who work with the youth, the kids, and even the ones that work with the senior adults. I think about all the different things going on in our church. And I appreciate those who work. Amen? I appreciate every one of you. And we, as a church, should appreciate them. But guess what we should also do? We should help them. We should encourage them. We should love on them. We should support them. And I think I already said it one time, which I know I have, but I'm going to say it again. We should help them. You see, just as Jerusalem sensed the need, they heard what God was doing down there, and they sensed the need to expand the ministry, you and I, it needs to be in our head that we need to expand the ministry. You say, well, we're pretty good right now. No, we're not. We'll never be good till the Lord comes home. Amen? We might be comfortable and we might be doing all right, but I'm telling you what, unless we're trying to expand the kingdom of God, we're not doing what God tells us to do. So we need to think about that. Let me say this. I think we should see some new people desiring to work in the ministry. Anticipation, approval. But look on in verse 23, we see the affirmation of his calling. Who, when he came, and here's Barnabas, here he comes. Now, I don't know how long it takes to go 300 miles on a mule or walking or however he got there on a chariot, but he got there. And the Bible says, when he came and had seen the grace of God, was glad and exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord, being a Barnabas. Barnabas shows up on the scene. Barnabas didn't say, now wait a minute, I'm from the church of Jerusalem. I'm the rabbi, I'm the pastor, I'm the teacher, I'm the anointed one. My name used to mean exalted, now it needs encouragement. Let me encourage y'all. No, he didn't say that. He got there and he realized that God was already at work and that God was doing a wonderful and a great thing, and he got excited about it. Amen. Same thing as you and I ought to do. He was excited about it. He said he saw, this is what's beautiful, he saw the grace of God. Another way to say that is he saw the work of God. Friends, let me tell you something. I see the work of God. I hope you, have you seen God work in this church? I have. I hope everybody has. You should have. As of yet, Barnabas had not made an individual contribution to the work that was going on in Antioch, but he was excited about it. Man, I can just see him getting there. And like, man, this is cool. This is a whole lot going on here. See, when Barnabas arrived in Antioch, he rejoiced at what the Lord had done, and he sought to encourage the church there because there were new believers in faith. Barnabas didn't show up on the scene. Now, the way we do it in Jerusalem, it's amazing to me. How some folks will show up somewhere and say, I like it around here, and then change it and do everything they can to change it. And I've seen people come into a church and say, boy, I like this church, got a good feeling, and then they try to change it. Why? Barnabas didn't try to change them. Barnabas says, hey, man, you got a good thing going on here. Praise the Lord. Amen. And that's exactly what Barnabas did. We must develop an attitude of affirming other people. You know, sometimes I need to be affirmed. Sometimes you need to be affirmed. The deacons, the teachers, everybody needs to be affirmed in our work for the Lord. So think about that. Barnabas was generally happy. Now we've seen the calling of Barnabas, and we'll touch on this a little bit later, but over in chapter 13, verse 2, we'll see specifically where God separates. In fact, just go ahead and flip over there right quick. Chapter 13, verse 2. And they administered to the Lord and fasted. The Holy Ghost said, now here, listen. Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them to. Of course, we know Saul is Paul. But I think it's kind of neat that God put Barnabas' name first. He called. Separate. Separated and called. Now let me move on quickly to see about the character of Barnabas. Look in verse 24. The Bible says, for he was a good man and full of the Holy Ghost and of faith, and much people was added unto the Lord. You see, in this verse right here, we were given the details regarding the character of Barnabas. Think about his character. Think about who he was. In other words, think about his identity. When we think about his identity, Barnabas was described as a good man. one who was known and respected by his peers. His life had been examined by those who knew him. That's exactly what we do when we pull out deacons or we pull out teachers. Somebody that's been here for a while. Somebody that's proved themselves. Somebody that everybody knows that this is a good person. But most importantly, this is a person that's full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. You see, physical abilities can be learned, at least most of them. Many of you have worked with me for several years now, and I just can't get the habit of building anything right or mechanicking on anything that's right. Maybe some of you are that way. But physical abilities, your physical ability could be learned. Anybody didn't learn anything? Anybody born didn't know how to do something? Somebody taught them how to do it? At some point in time, right? This means yes, that means no. You can answer me. You learn something at some point in time in your life. Physical abilities can be learned. But I'm telling you, character is in here. Character is in here. Genuine character comes from within. And that's when you're full of faith and full of the Holy Spirit. There's more to a man than his ability. There's more to a man than his ability. I'll say something about that in just a few minutes. Churches and ministries need those of moral character. Listen to this story. I saw it on the news just a couple weeks ago. Maybe you saw it. This lady reporter was so mad because she wanted to interview this particular politician, believe running for senator or something like that. And the only time he had was his drive to the next campaign stop, and he was going by himself. And this lady says, "Let me ride along with you, and I'll interview you." And he said, "No." Now, she got all bent out of shape about it. But here's why he said no. "My wife and I have made a commitment that we'll never be alone with the opposite sex without each other present." Now, I don't know about you, but I'd vote for this man based on his character. Character is so, so important. His identity, who he was. And then going on in verse 24, we see that Barnabas was also known to be full of the Holy Ghost and faith. See, his life was not lived in an effort to promote himself, but he was concerned about others. God is able to equip us, amen, for the area of service that he chooses to place us in. Anybody know that? I think one person said, "I do." Y'all come with me. Come back. God equips us for service. Let me say this. God is more concerned about your availability than your ability. And let me back that up by saying this. Your availability will far exceed your ability. Does that make sense? Your availability will far exceed your ability. He inspired people. The Bible says in verse 24, "And much people was added unto the Lord." Barnabas impacted their lives. Think of somebody right now that's impacted your life. Maybe they had lots and lots and lots of abilities. Maybe they could do lots of things. But I'm going to tell you, folks, they wasn't born with it. They learned it at some point in time. They made themselves available. So we've seen the calling and the character of Barnabas. One final thing today. Let's look at the cooperation of Barnabas because this is important. It's one thing to be called. It's one thing to have character. But when you begin to do what God's called you to do, that cooperation. Look at verse 25. "Then departed Barnabas to Tarsus for to seek Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him back into Antioch." Barnabas knew that the work was too great, that there's something that he couldn't do alone. So he sought help. Anybody remember learning that lesson? It's not a weakness to ask for help. You agree? Too many people think, "I'm weak if I need help." I'm going to tell you something right now. I need help of every second of every day. There's very little I can do. And I thank God today that I get help. We need help. And Barnabas went and got help. You know what I call that? I call that wisdom. That's being a wise man. The Bible says he was full of the Holy Spirit and of what? Faith. You get full of the Holy Spirit and get full of faith, something's going to happen. Something's going to take place. Something's going to bend. Something's going to break. When you get full of the Holy Spirit and you get whole and full of faith, something's going to happen in your life. God's got to admit, I don't want to get full of that. God may want me to do something. But when you get full of the Holy Spirit and you get full of faith, friend, let me tell you something. There's nothing you can't do. There's nothing. Nothing you can't do. Barnabas knew that he needed help and he went and got it. I'd call that wisdom. There was much to do. And he knew he was not going to be able to do it all. You and I need to be very sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit when we need help. There's some areas of the church that we need help in. I'm not saying what they are. I've got my thoughts. Maybe some of you have thoughts. But I believe that there's some areas of the church that we need help in. We're always going to need help. It'd be wise for us to ask for help, wouldn't it? It'd be wise. There's a great work, and there's a great work now. Which that wisdom leads us into work. Two more things. Verse 26. And it came to pass that a whole year that they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. Barnabas remained faithful to the task. He went and got Saul, and they come back, and they preached and teach for a whole year. For a whole year, solid. And the Bible says that many people come to faith. Barnabas remained faithful to where God placed him until it was time to leave. Priorities. We need the kind of commitment that Barnabas had to do the work of Christ. And then finally there you see his witness. And the disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. You know what that means? That means that the people, guess what? It wasn't the church calling themselves Christians. Let's get this right. The church said, hey, we're going to be called Christians. It was society. It was the religious people on the outside that wasn't really spiritual at all. And they looked in, and guess what they did? They connected the church with Christ. That's the connection. They connected the church with Christ. The people were able to connect the work of the church with Christ. That's why they're called Christians. Christ ones. They belong to Christ. Our church belongs to Christ. Amen? Amen, church? This church belongs to Jesus Christ. He paid for it. He bled for it. He died for it. And he rose for it. This church belongs. I belong to Jesus Christ. And I hope that every single one of you this morning belong to Jesus Christ. That's what it's all about. It's not about who's doing what or who gets the credit. It's about glorifying Jesus Christ. It's about sharing the gospel and seeing lives transform for Christ. It's about investing in the lives of others. So even if you're called to serve in the shadows, serve with gladness. Serve with gladness because you're serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God, I pray today that if there's one here who does not know for sure that they belong to Jesus Christ, let them know today. May your Holy Spirit fill them, God, that they might see that today's the day that they can belong to Jesus Christ. God, you're knocking at the heart's door and you want to come in. Lord, I pray if today is the day for someone, they'll have the power to make that decision. You give them the power. If there be one here today, Lord, that's walking far from you that needs to come back. And God, if there's somebody here that says, you know what? I've been called to serve in the shadows. And I've been thinking I'm not getting any credit or recognition. But I just realize it's just an honor to serve you. Lord, there's so many other decisions that might be on people's hearts and minds. Lord, I want the people to know, the whole church to know that this altar is open. It may not have anything to do with what I've preached about today, but it has to do with you. So God, help us to know that we can come lay our burdens down here at this altar. God, just help us to do this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand and sing, you respond as the Lord gives you. Seat for just a second. And I'm so happy. I was supposed to do something I didn't forget. Give me just a minute here. We're gonna take up a love offering, and I know that many of you came prepared and want to help Dexter and Lois. There's a lot of things. Thank you, Bobby. There's a lot of things. You know, they're going through. Lois has been having to stay in a motel quite a bit. And we just want to love on our church family, amen? So we'll just pass the plate and you play something. Whatever you want to play. This is for Dexter and Lois Barker. And Debbie and Nick. Tell you, if you forgot and didn't come prepared, you can always bring it later. right. God bless you. You're dismissed.